301 in the East Coast in Washington, D.C., and with those notes from the song Corazón Latino, which is also the name of the one of the organizations that is presenting this webinar, I welcome you all. It is very exciting. Happy International Day of Forests. I want to make sure that everybody who is now on this webinar is where they're supposed to be. This is the webinar to celebrate the International Day of Forests, Trees, Cities, and Human Health. And if by any chance this is not where you intend to be, I highly recommend that you stick around because it's going to be really, really an interesting session. So let me see. We have an hour for this event, and let's get started. So my name is Felipe Benitez. I'm executive director of Corazón Latino. And this is the first of a series of webinars that Corazón Latino, Green Latinos, Americas for Conservation and the Arts, Voces, CREA, and many others will start conducting, we're hoping every month, about issues related to nature, health, well-being of communities. And what better way to kickstart it by doing it on the International Day of Forests. So I'm gonna, before we start the formal introductions and the actual run of show, I want to introduce to my colleague, Sonia Rangel. She's gonna give you some guidance, some housekeeping rules, and we can get started. Sonia.
Thank you. If we could go to the next slide. I just wanted to have a little bit of reminders. Currently, all participants' microphones are muted. Only the panelists are unmuted. If you do have a question during this presentation, feel free to type your questions in the question and answer box that should be in the Zoom meeting. A heads up, this webinar is recorded, and if you would like the recorded webinar, it can be requested. In addition, all the resources that we will discuss today during the webinar can be requested to me at sonia@corazonlatino.us. And I turn it back over to Felipe.
Thank you, Sonia. And as I was mentioning, this is the first webinar and a collaboration with Corazón Latino, Green Latinos, Americas for Conservation and the Arts, Voces, CREA Results, and we're hoping a lot more partners will join us in this great adventure. Some of the speakers that you will be listening to today, it's myself, Felipe Benitez, Mark Magaña, who's the president and founder of Green Latinos. The highlight of this webinar, which will be Kathleen Wolf, researcher and social scientist from the University of Washington, Dr. Tamberly Conway, partnership diversity and inclusion specialist from the U.S. Forest Service, my dear friend Irene Vilar, director and founder of Americas for Conservation and the Arts, and Fernando Pineda Reyes, chief executive officer of CREA Results. So, as I mentioned, this is the first of what we hope will be many similar events. And we wanted to do it today on the International Day of Forest, as you know, this is something, it's a holiday, it's a key date that the United Nations promotes around the world. And this year, the theme of the day of today's Days of Forests is the collaborative partnership of forests and the forests and sustainable cities. So that's what we thought, that that Dr. Wolf's presentation will fit perfectly today, and you'll see why. Her research is amazing, showing what all of us know, what all of us assume, that it's that green spaces, forests, trees are provide benefits to our communities. And by the way, International Day of Forests, you have probably already have, but if not, I urge you to go out and hug a tree. That's how you celebrate it. It's actually going to be great for you, great for your day, and it's a way to celebrate, to honor our friends that did a lot for us. I think that's it in this point for me. So I want to leave the microphone to Mark Magaña. And I must say, he's probably what I would call the godfather of the Green Latinos movement here in the US. And I'm really, he's a great partner, a great leader, a mentor, a role model, and a mover and shaker in this space. So Mark, are you around?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Felipe, and everyone on this panel. For bringing us together on this important International Day of Forests, talk about the importance of forests in public health for the Latino community. I grew up in Los Angeles, and my parents, we couldn't afford to fly us everywhere for vacations or holidays or going to Disney World or whatever. So we fortunately growing up in California, are around a lot of national parks. And so has always been an amazing opportunity for my family to appreciate the outdoors. But when we were home in LA, in California, you have an assortment of natural disasters or things that happen, forest fires, mudslides, earthquakes, storms, droughts. But as a child growing up, the worst thing for us were the days that we weren't allowed to go out and play because the air quality was too low. It was too dirty. The smog was too high, and it was dangerous for our health. And as a child, being told you can't go outside and play because your health is at risk because of your forms of dirty energy, it just became the new normal. Our parents would have to check the forecast and see if we were allowed to go out and play. And that's odd to be able to tell a child, nope, the air you breathe, the air outside is not healthy. You need to stay inside. And when we were allowed to go outside, our friends would have to take we'd be playing football or basketball or any games, and we'd have to stop the game so that some of our friends could take puffs of their inhaler because they had asthma and they just couldn't play for very long without taking a puff. And that just became the new normal. We would take an inhaler break. And that, for a child to be like, I am risking my health. I am not being allowed to play outside because we are adapting to dirty energy sources. It's just a real shame. But when we would go camping, when we would drive up and out of the basin of Los Angeles, when we'd reach that point where we could unload the car and unload the tent, and we'd open the door and take that first breath of that clean, cold, thin air, and you just realized you were in a special place. You were in the forest. You were among the trees. And it made you really appreciate the difference. And it was sad because it was such a significant difference from where you lived health-wise and breathing. But it was amazing because every time you'd go camping, you would wait for that first breath of fresh, clean, crisp air. And you'd see the trees. And you would just jump out of the car and you'd start running. And you seemed like you could run forever. And my sister and I would run around and play freeze tag among the trees. And my dad would give us a penny for every pop top can top we could pull out of the ground. And so for myself and for many Latinos, the outdoors, picnicking, barbecuing, the parks, the beaches, the forests, the reserves, those are all special places that we could afford, that we could bring our whole family together because there were no limitations in numbers. Bring them around the fire, bring them around the barbecue, bring them around the soccer game, bring them around talking to each other. It was spiritual and it still is. And we cannot afford to allow this administration to reduce our access to the parks by increasing fees, to reduce the health of our parks by allowing more drilling and mining, and to reduce our faith that the federal government is going to, should be entrusted with taking care of our lands. And so right now it is on to us to protect our forests, to protect our air, to protect our health of us and our future generations. And for the Latino community, it's all about our future generations. It's all about our communities being under attack from polluting industries and how we can push back and how we as a country with cultural, community where conservation is part of our culture, have a deep respect for the land, have a deep respect for public health, for our children, and this connection maintains from generation to the next as we pass it on. One final note, Felipe, I want to take the time to mention that we are inviting everyone to Rocky Mountain, Colorado, to Estes Park for our Green Latinos National Summit, May 22nd through the 25th. You can find more information at greenlatinos.org/2018summit. It's an opportunity for you to get that fresh air, to get the camaraderie with 200 plus other Latino environmental and conservation advocates. And so again, Felipe and everyone on this call, thank you for inviting me and thank you for hosting this. It's an important time for all of us and happy International Day of Forests.
Thank you very much, Mark. And yes, let's make an effort to have some bonding time and share experiences, share knowledge at this Green Latinos event. And don't forget what researchers and social research call the social capital, connecting with new friends, reconnecting with old friends. It is a great opportunity to bring all the voices, and we need to bring even within our diverse community, we need to bring even more diverse voices. So please do make that effort, and if you can, please try to attend this awesome event. So now we're moving into our main attraction. It's like the circus, but it's not. Our great speaker today, Dr. Wolf. Dr. Wolf is a research in social science from the University of Washington School of Environmental and Social Sciences at the Pacific Northwest. Associate at the Pacific Northwest Research Station of the USDA Forest Service. And she has done amazing research. It's really hard to get on her schedule because these topics that she's going to be talking to us about are in high demand. So we were lucky to get some of her time, and that obviously she needs to prepare and she needs to make sure that she's presenting the best of what's out there. But we're really, really, really fortunate to have her with us in this very iconic day. So with no further ado, and Dr. Wolf, I don't want to steal your thunder, and I want you to tell us what brings you to where you are, where you your background, which is very interesting, and just take it away. I think we're really excited to have you. Thank you very much, and thank you everybody who's joining for being part of this new and exciting adventure.
Felipe, thank you so much for the invitation and for the introduction, and Mark, wonderful comments to kick off not only this session, but the webinar series. So I'm going to pull up some slides now, just take a moment here. All right, just checking, things look fine there from my computer.
They look right here.
Good, thank you very much. All right, I've been invited to speak, to share with you for about 30 minutes or so here, some of the current research about health, trees and health, human health in our cities. You know, and so many people around us really take trees for granted. They're not seen as an essential part of our city in many communities or in many locations around the world. And in part, my work is an effort to change those attitudes, to bring people to a greater awareness of what these wonderful things are that are growing around them, these wonderful organisms that produce so many benefits. And in the short time that I have, what I'd like to do is focus on human health and how trees are related from a science perspective. Mark shared a wonderful story, really a series of stories from his life and his experience of forests. I'm going to take a little more clinical perspective as a scientist, and I'm going to move through a lot of content very quickly. As you may note, this session is being recorded, so if there's anything you'd like to go back and review, it will be available. But what I'm hoping is to sort of set up a foundation of what we understand from a research perspective. And no doubt other speakers, other webinars will backfill or provide more detail that is relevant to communities and individuals and families with regard to trees and human health. I'll start with a definition of health, and that is it's a comprehensive state of wellness. It's not simply going to the doctor or the hospital when you're ill or disease or you have a disease, but it's the whole bundle of circumstances and situations in your community and your everyday life that contribute to your health. People who work in public health are using the term social determinants to describe this broad span of economic, cultural, and environmental situations, including having job opportunities and including having good education, including having nutritious food, as well as the ambient sort of nature conditions around one's home, be it trees, parks, gardens, or as Mark pointed out, even air quality. Again, I'm going to share a very brief overview of the range of science that we now understand. And this is a web portal sponsored with funding from the Forest Service, where we have collected, a team of students and I over several years now have collected the research found in many different disciplines, many different journals, and we have shared it as a series of web pages at this website, Green Cities Good Health. And if you Google search that, you should be able to find this website. If you visit this informational resource, what you find is about a dozen topics there on the left, spanning from community building through active living, mental health and function, and so on. And for each page, then, there is a quick introduction, some fast facts, and these are some of the statistical highlights that we have found as we've reviewed articles, and you might find them helpful for grant proposals or annual reports or making the case to your local officials for more trees and more parks. Following that then is a longer summary all of it fully cited. So if you are interested in going to the original sources, they are listed at the end of each summary. What do we see in this literature? I have been working on this project now for several years and continue to try to find, screen for articles. We are now up to over 4,000 articles, peer-reviewed publications about the relationships between nature and cities and human health. And first of all, we see a wide span of nature situations or places that promote health. Urban forest canopy, having parks and gardens, biophilic design, which is this idea that architects and landscape architects, they're literally pulling nature into our built structures, into our buildings, into our homes, because of the importance of nature experience. And then some interesting developments in green infrastructure. If we're putting in infrastructure to manage water, for instance, stormwater, we can think of these spaces as micro parks and perhaps design them to promote better health for the people who live around them. We're also seeing in this literature that, and I'm speaking about the research literature, we're seeing that all people benefit. People in different locations, different types of communities, different types of residential settings, people of various cultural backgrounds, people of various socioeconomic status, people who are active in parks versus people who are perhaps not as active but have a view of nature from a window at their workplace or at their home. All people appear to benefit from having encounters with nature. The Green Cities Good Health website, to our surprise, has become the basis for a few additional collaborations to share this sort of knowledge. And here's one that we did in collaboration with the Nature Conservancy called Outside Our Doors. Again, it is available as a PDF. If you search that, TNC, Outside Our Doors, you'll probably be able to find that pretty quickly. This one was recently released by the Forest Service, another attempt to summarize the broad extent and character of this science. And if you search this title, Forest Service, this just came out last month. And so you should be able to find that again as a PDF document. Most of what I'm talking about is actually work done not only by myself as a social scientist, but people all over the world, this community of science that spans different nations, different communities, different universities and agencies. My own work, some of my own recent work has focused on estimating the economic values, the financial benefits of these health benefits. And this, while we have done peer-reviewed publications, this is an outreach document, again, in collaboration with the Nature Conservancy. And thanks to the Forest Service, it has now been translated to Spanish and Arabic. And I believe we'll have a little more information about that a little later in the webinar. But if not, a follow-up email will be sure to share these links. So if you're interested, you can access these documents. Within the Nature's Riches document, what we've done is to lay out across the human life cycle, from infants, babies, to children, adults, and older adults, the range of benefit that people gain from experiences of nature, and then turning the crank one more turn and translating that to economic benefit. And I'm so thankful to my colleagues, Steve Grado, Mark Measles, and Alicia Robbins. They're all economists who have collaborated on this project and to make sure that our numbers are robust and defensible as we talk about why plants, trees, parks, gardens, and all of these things are important in our lives. So the review that we've done that has generated Green Cities Good Health is an overview of nearby nature and health evidence. It's more than 4,000 publications. And I'm sometimes fascinated when people talk to me about this, they exclaim, oh, you know, I just found out about this new kind of research that's being done. And I'm a little amused because I know that it's been going on for over 40 years. But what's really interesting is because there's so much being published now, I think we've hit a critical mass of both understanding and public awareness about why we need nature in our everyday lives. And as a scientist, early on in my career, I was very much more focused on data and information. And that's what scientists do. We collect data, we analyze it, and we translate it to information and share that by way of publications and talks. But I'm finding as I'm getting older, I'm more interested in taking this another step to knowledge. Knowledge that has meaning and has value for people, people who are not scientists. And so as I have looked over this collection of science and publication, I thought, what are the stories here? You know, rather than just sharing bullet points of findings, what is the story? And here's one story that I'll quickly share today. And that is, across the entire life cycle, from cradle to grave, we need nature in our lives. And we have the studies to show why this story makes sense and why it's important. So I'll start on one end of the cradle to grave, the human life cycle, and that's infants. And studies have been done around the world, Madrid, Los Angeles, Vancouver, British Columbia, London, and the first, to my knowledge, done in Portland, Oregon by Jeff Donovan and his colleagues in the Forest Service, finding that having, in this case, this particular study, tree canopy cover within a fairly short distance around the home of a woman who is pregnant, there then is a relationship to having healthier babies, fewer babies of low birth weight. And this is important because birth weight has an influence on the health, not only of the infant, but as they grow up, babies, children who are of low birth weight may not perform as better in school. And they may even have a greater propensity to disease in middle age, cardiovascular disease. So baby birth weight, having nature near your home appears to be important. As children get older, they're more active, of course, very active. And John Gathright is an arborist who has done research in Japan. He's Canadian, but has lived in Japan for some time. And he has a recreational tree climbing program, but it's also a therapy program. And he's there in the image on the bottom right. And if you look closely at these children, they have minor birth defects. Not sure why, but extra digits, fewer digits, they're fully functional as people. But because of these minor birth defects, sometimes they're shunned, socially shunned, bullied, and so on. And so John has been working with a therapy group for these kids that includes tree climbing. And it's a physical activity. It builds social capital. It builds self-esteem and is really just a wonderful program. And I have to say, it looks like they're having a little fun doing this. I am hearing more and more about recreational and therapy tree climbing programs in different cities. So it's something that you might consider in your own location. Again, in a more clinical sense, in Sacramento, California, I was part of this research team. We accessed LIDAR data, which is a high resolution tree canopy assessment approach, and CHIS, California Health Inventory Survey, which is an ongoing health survey across the entire state of California. So we pulled the data for Sacramento County, and what we did was to compare the tree data to the health data, and we found that with more trees, people had better overall health. They also had better sense of social cohesion. And why is that important? It's because people who work in public health are finding that being socially connected, we're such a social species, being socially connected is important for good health. People who are lonely or isolated, particularly more elderly people, are more prone to disease and illness. Another study looking or using remote sensing, using big data about trees, in this case, tracking where EAB, which is the emerald ash borer, It is an insect that has caused a lot of damage to urban forests in the northern United States. And in these instances, the bug arrives where there are many ash trees. The trees are diseased. They die fairly quickly. The city has to remove them because they become hazards. You don't want them falling on cars and people in homes. Another image to the far right would be a neighborhood that looks very different, barren, no vegetation, no trees. So again, Jeff Donovan and his colleagues, they were able to access data about the tree removal. They were able to access data, public health data from counties. They statistically compared these two things and found a difference in cardiovascular and respiratory disease. Higher rates of these diseases in those places after the trees were removed. So same population, it's kind of a natural experiment. It's very difficult to do medical experiments with tree canopy because it takes so long to introduce this intervention. So this is an interesting natural experiment. We're finding also a collection of research about trees, nature, and mental health. Here's a study from Mark Berman. He's at the University of Chicago. He and his colleagues recruited people who were diagnosed with major depression. They were randomly assigned to two different walking paths. Some people walked through a more built environment, the red line. Others walked through a more green residential area, the green line, including an arboretum. This was done in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where I went to grad school. And as a grad student, I spent a lot of time in that arboretum seeking stress reduction and relaxation. But anyway, what they found is that after people did just a short walk, 50-minute walk, that they were in a better mood and they were more attentive. They were able to focus on tasks better. So here we see both mental health and function as a result of fairly brief experiences in nature, walking through nature. A series of studies have come out of Japan and Korea about shinrin-yoku, forest bathing. This is some of the best science in terms of science rigor and method about the value of trees and health. And they have found reduced stress, improved immune function, reduced diabetes symptoms, as well as other benefits, to the point now where Japan has a network system of forest bathing stations and bases where one can go to intentionally have these sorts of experiences. And they're fairly brief. They can be several hours, maybe a day, maybe a weekend, but again, with remarkable results. And finally, at the end of the life cycle, as we age, some nations are seeing an increase in the rate of dementia and cognitive disorders in older people. And some patients then are in care facilities. And in this particular study, they looked at the response of people who had a wander garden, a garden where someone could go outside the building within a controlled space so that the staff can continue to watch them and so that they're safe and secure. But what they found was a reduction in the amount of medications within these facilities and also fewer falls. Why? Well, in being able to go out and walk, it's likely that people maintained good personal mobility, and so they were less likely to fall, which is important for health and reducing associated injuries or diseases. The other reduction in medications, why would that be? Well, often dementia patients are agitated, they're frustrated. And in these sorts of facilities, the treatment is to give sedatives to calm them down. Well, if you're more calm because you've been out walking or in contact with nature and pollinators and the fascination of nature, perhaps you're less agitated and need fewer medications. So what this takes us to, I've given you a very quick overview, a story from cradle to grave, nature's benefits across our life cycle. But there's so many things, questions that we could still explore. And this is an article, if you're interested in reading about that, this is an article that colleagues and I did a little bit ago. It was out last year about a research agenda concerning nature and human health. And it outlines key questions that are really important as we continue to do this, not only to study more, but to think about how to implement these things, how to create better nature spaces in our cities. And so I'll end here with just a few studies that start to suggest how we take this to policy, all right? First, that top line on this slide, there's a general association. People with higher income have access to better health care and generally have better health. But here we see in this study that was done in Toronto that having trees in your community may be a partial offset to the income disparities and healthcare access disparities. And that is, this community found, or in this community it was found, that having more trees was equivalent to greater personal income and greater neighborhood income in terms of health consequences. An equivalence, if you will, of having trees and income influences on health. Here's another really interesting study that was done by Dr. Zhang with Bill Sullivan at the University of Illinois. And what they did was, this was an experimental approach. It was in a lab. They showed people images having varying degrees of tree canopy ranging from 0 to 60%. That's the red line. See the difference in canopy. Then they measured stress response. The people in the study were stressed and then shown images, different images of canopy and tested for effects. What we see, the blue line indicates the stress response. And it's not as linear as the images of canopy cover, but there is a general tendency of stress improvement, reduced stress. What they found was an interesting threshold at about 40%, suggesting that maybe, in other words, increasing the amount of canopy beyond 40% didn't introduce as much or as much degree of stress recovery. So maybe this sets a policy goal. We set policy goals for tree canopy cover based on environmental services such as water and air quality and carbon and so on. But here we have a public health benchmark for policy for canopy cover. And the last one here, very interesting, vegetation and mental health. And in this study, they showed people again various vegetation cover, as well as other factors that one would find in your community, including bird abundance. But what they found was a reduced depression, anxiety, and stress. And it was associated with different levels of canopy cover. So with greater 20% greater or greater canopy cover, reduced depression. 30% canopy cover, reduced anxiety. 20% cover, reduced stress. So again, we're starting to see within this research a connection or the sharing of numbers that start to set some policy guidelines, benchmarks, or metrics for our communities in terms of tree planting and providing nearby nature experiences. And here's one more, trees and physical activity. Children in a Canada study, and they found they looked at various proportions of tree cover, and they found that with each 5% increase in canopy cover, they found a 5% increase in physical activity outside of school hours, so after school activity. Again, suggesting that we're seeing some fairly direct relationships between health outcomes and how much trees, how much nature one has in your local environment. All right, I just touched the surface of nature benefits, health, and health outcomes. We have nearly 40 years of research. There are stories embedded within this research that are more interesting than just sharing bullet points, and cradle to grave is one of those. We have a critical mass of evidence that suggests we can now begin to act on this, and I see the emergence of a lot of programs that encourage, enable, and welcome people to be active in parks and within streetscapes and within their community. So we can start to integrate urban forest goals and nature goals within our cities with other community needs, education, physical activity, and so on. So many opportunities starting to come along. If you'd like more information, here's sort of my digital resume, if you will. And with that, I will now turn this back over to Felipe and to the speakers on our webinar. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Kathy. We're calling her Kathy because we're making her an honorary Latina. So it's now Kathy Wolf, but not Kathy, Kathy. So many questions, so many ideas that come from your great presentation. But I think, at least from my end, one, I'm going to take a walk as soon as this ends. I need the fresh air. I need to get a little bit more inspiration to face the rest of the day, but also to celebrate the International Day of Forest. I'm probably going to try to plant a tree in the next couple of days. So that's my commitment. You have inspired me to do that, Kathy. I want to now invite Dr. Tamberly Conway from the U.S. Forest Service to tell us a little bit what the U.S. Forest Service has been doing directly through partners. And we'll be sharing a very exciting a surprise that we prepared for this webinar. So Tamberly, please go. Take it away, please.
Thank you, Felipe. And thank you so much to you, Sonia Corazon Latino, and all of the amazing partners today for hosting this incredible first shot and at this webinar series and on this International Day of Forest. Dr. Wolf, we are extremely grateful to you for taking time to join us today and sharing this incredible information, very important information, with a very different audience. I think that, you know, one of the aspects that we're really looking at today is, and one of the exciting aspects is that we are reaching really a diverse audience. I know that we, through our Green Latinos partners, Americans for Conservation of the Arts, Corazon Latino, Creative Results, Voices, they shot it out to their networks around the nation and also at an international level. And so we're reaching Latino leaders and other diverse leaders with this information who can then make sure that their communities have access to these resources. And in line with those resources, one of the things in which the Forest Service is deeply engaged is a limited English proficiency program initiative managed by Ricardo Martinez, who's really taken this to a great level. And we've been able to work with Dr. Wolf, with Corazon Latino, and creating the Nature's Riches publications. And then also we're working with Dr. Wolf to translate some of the Green Cities Good Health and transcreate those when needed as well. So we look forward to, and hope you look forward to, future opportunities to see some of these products that we're then sharing on the Descubre el Bosque website, where you will see a number of Spanish language resources that are being shared both on the web and then through social media.
To interrupt you, I think this is a perfect moment. I think I've been, because of my lack of experience working with this platform, I was already, I think I shared a couple of times, but we created, based on Dr. Wolf's work and the summary publication that she created, or that she led, we created two infographics that basically try to summarize the major findings and the major recommendations. So it is. So Sonia probably has already copied the link, so you can download it in PDF. But feel free to share it. Feel free to utilize it. This is a part of our contribution to disseminating this information, which is so important. And I don't want to give a quick shout out because I've seen some familiar names. I saw Carla from Mi Familia Bota. I've seen Moms Clean Air Force, EDF, a lot of allies, a lot of people from the Forest Service. Thank you very much for joining. I even saw Naomi Sachs, but I think she, another great researcher, which we want to invite for future webinars. But thank you very much for joining us. I'm sorry, but I just want to make sure that you guys knew that this is available go to Descubre el Bosque. We'll be sharing information there, and feel free to utilize this infographics.
No, that was the perfect insert. Thank you, Felipe, for sharing that. And it's a beautiful resource. And we look forward to seeing many more of these resources being shared. And one of the ways in which we're sharing, and I just want to highlight a few of the programs in which the Forest Service is engaged, is involved, and helps to fund some of these community-based grassroots efforts that really help to bring these information, this informational opportunity and these resources to diverse communities. And one in which we've been engaged for many, many years around the Health and Nature Initiative is the National Environmental Education Foundation. You can find information on their website about connections between health and nature and kind of the Nature RX or Nature Prescriptions programs, in which they've been working with doctors around the nation to create nature champions to write prescriptions for outdoor activity. That really led us to our partnership with Nature Explore. It's Nature Explore Outdoor Classrooms, in which these classrooms are created, or outdoor spaces are created, to enhance opportunities, especially in underserved communities, for individuals and youth and their families who do not normally have access to that public green space or that urban green space. We've recently embarked upon a great journey with the medical community, in which we're establishing Nature Explore sites in some of the medical centers. Also, our next one is at the Shands Children's Hospital in Gainesville, Florida. We've established one in partnership with many, like the Texas Forest Service and Lone Star Family Health Center in Conroe, Texas. And those served, again, as great models for really applying this nature-based connection. And we're hopeful to work with Dr. Naomi Sachs with the Therapeutic Landscapes Network and the Biophilic Cities Network as well, and establishing some of these sites that would really tie in that therapeutic landscape design. One of the visions is to establish one of these sites at the with ParkRx America, with NEEF, the National Environmental Education Foundation, at one of the Unity Healthcare sites here in DC. This is a wonderful shared vision that we're leaning towards and partnering. Right now, we just established a partnership with the ParkRx America program and Corazon Latino to partner together in creating increased avenues for community-based outreach, education, and that really deep-seated connection with the natural world that increases health benefits, mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual health benefits. And much of this was actually inspired by one of the programs and one of our phenomenal partners, the Americas for Conservation and the Arts, and one of their kind of branch partners, so to speak, CREA Results. They established the Promotoras Verdes program, which has been just a phenomenal success, in which the CREA Results organization, which is really connected to kind of the health promoters in the community, specifically within the Latino community, partner with Irene Villar, who is the founder and director of Americas for Conservation of Art, and who is really using art to connect people to nature. And they joined forces and unified to create the Promotoras Verdes program, whereby they take, up to 150 individuals out, all families, out to, say, a local park or a local forest or a national forest, and engage them in really amazing, like, Project Learning Tree programs, Nature Explore programs, Discover the Forest activities, to help them really understand the value of the resources around them, and also to more deeply connect with nature where they are and providing those health benefits. So I'm not sure if Rene was able to join us, or Fernando, or do you all see them out there, Sonia and Felipe?
Thank you, Rene. I was on a flight heading to Mexico, okay. You gave a good
sure.
Overview, and we'll make sure that include. But you want to add anything else?
About the I just wanted to really thank Renee and highlight that work and helping to plant the seed for some of our future work. I know the Forest Service is also engaged in some projects around the nation and with engaging doctors and taking individuals out to, say, forest lands or to local parks to really improve the health of individuals in their communities and especially patients. But also I'll mention that there is a great interest in how we can incorporate these designs in medical facilities and in really helping to create some health benefits for both staff and doctors. And Barton Hospital is one of those around that the Forest Service is partnering with specifically to kind of increase some of these avenues for patient therapy. And we're also hoping to work with the Association for Nature and Forest Therapy and providing some avenues for forest and nature therapy and forest bathing. So with that, I will turn it back over to you, Felipe, with just a deep sense of gratitude for all that you have been able to pull together here and providing this avenue to reach really broad and diverse audiences with this information. And thank you again, Dr. Wolf, for joining us today.
Great. And now thank you. Thanks everybody for participating. Sonia, I believe we have a couple of questions. So do you want to remind folks how to do it? And please lead the next part of this conversation.
And Felipe, if you will, may I just mention as well, I didn't mention where that Promotores Verde program was launched. It is actually in Denver, Colorado, and in partnership with the local U.S. Forest Service offices there and their urban forestry program. So I just wanted to make sure, you know, so that people can go and check out more information. I'm sure we can provide some links to that particular program when we send out the archived version of this webinar. Thank you.
And I see Dana Coelho in as one of the participants. So big shout out to Dana because she's been a strong force behind this. So Sonia.
Yes, of course. Thank you so much, everybody, for attending. I did see a lot of you here participating on the chat, and I did get some questions for most of them, all of them addressed to Dr. Wolf and her presentation. The first one that I would like to ask is, how can communities increase equitable access to underserved communities to nature and programs that support health of all communities?
Let's see. Wow, there are so many answers to that question. as a scientist, let me respond. Mm-hmm. What I have noted in, maybe the last 5-6 years, perhaps, and I think it's because scientists are able to do big data analysis. They're able to take really large data sets across large geographic areas, a lot of vegetation, information, be it remote sensing, LIDAR, whatever. And they have noted, they have discovered discrepancies in distribution of parks and trees and so on. And someone made a comment early on in the webinar that, you know, some people are very self-aware of the benefits of nature experience. I would say likewise, some people are very self-aware or community aware of the disparities of the availability of these sorts of resources. But when you have the numbers and the maps and the information that displays this discrepancies and or disparities in a more quantitative way, not only that, but the health research suggests that people can no longer say, oh, trees and gardens, aren't they pretty? But really, are they that important? They're very important. They're essential. They're absolutely necessary in everyone's lives. And because of that, I'm seeing more commitment and more resources provided for various communities, communities of color, communities of different cultural and socioeconomic backgrounds. And so the programs that other speakers on this webinar are talking about, I think, are a response. And they're some of the innovations. They are some of the really creative approaches to introducing people to nature who may not have had opportunities in the past, to welcome them and to do so within a suitable or an appropriate cultural context. So again, my work is more clinical, it's more data-driven, but what I see is local organizations, national organizations, are now providing the context that enables more and more people to enjoy and appreciate nature encounters in their communities.
Thank you very much for that response. Another question that I have here is, have you ever visited, well, speaking about forest bathing and forest therapists, have you ever visited Japan to experience Shirenjoku? And do you practice forest bathing here in the U.S.? And if so, would you recommend forest therapies becoming a national priority?
Yes. First of all, the question, I have participated in forest, extended forest walks in Japan. The people that I was with did not call it forest bathing, but observing other people around me, other Japanese people, I'm pretty sure that's what we were all about while we were out on various walks and hikes. What I find really interesting is in Japan, that experience is not competitive. It is an experience to just get out in a relaxed way at your own pace, be if you're young, if you're middle-aged, if you're an elder, at your own pace. Here in the United States, we tend to overlay being outdoors with this competitive edge. You know, we're timing ourselves and we're using Strava to compare our time to other people. We have to let go of that, I think, to really achieve the benefits of forest bathing. Could it be a national program? I think it's kind of moving slowly in that direction. I understand that there is now a forest bathing counselor training program somewhere. I don't know the details about it, but I think we're seeing far greater interest in this. One dimension of forest bathing I have not seen in the research and I think might be important is the spiritual and sacred component. Many of the places that I went to forest bathing in and around, particularly Kyoto, Osaka, Kobe, that area, central Japan, they were sacred forests associated with shrines and temples. And so there was the legacy of very old trees as well as destinations that were often sacred experiences for myself and for other people out in the trees. So that's a dimension that is not mentioned in the studies, but I suspect it's an important component and maybe something that we think about incorporating into our forest experiences, slowing down, looking for the sacred, appreciating the spiritual, perhaps, in these experiences.
That sounds just relaxing to hear. We have time for one final question, and this is from Erica Erickson. Dr. Wu, can you speak a little about park prescription programs?
I am aware of emerging programs, but I don't know a lot about the details of how they're implemented. But I do know there's one doctor who seems to be identified with Park's prescription or nature prescription. That is Dr. Czar, located in Washington, D.C. He and his colleagues have formed a nonprofit called Nature RX. And again, if you search that on the web, I'm sure it'll pop up pretty quickly. I don't know a lot of the detail about that organization, but I understand that it offers a toolkit and guidance for communities and medical professionals that would like to start a Parks prescription program.
Okay, great. I think.
Thank you very much, everybody. It's 3:59. We are almost at the hour. I want to be very respectful of everybody's time. Dr. Wolf mentioned Dr. Czar on Parks RX America. I think it was shared here. He's doing an amazing, amazing job in bringing the health community into this movement. They've incorporated not only the the scientific and the clinical background, but also they created applications so doctors can actually prescribe and through electronic health records keep track of the evolution of patients that are being prescribed these walks or hugging a tree or whatever is it that the doctor, and they also have in their website a search engine, which well, basically you put your zip code and we'll tell you what are the areas or the parks near you. And by the way, we also at Descubre el Bosque have a similar one, descubreelbosque.org or discovertheforest.org. Basically you go there, you put your zip code, and within 5, 10, 50, 100 mile radius will give you what are the public lands around you. I think definitely for probably next or in upcoming webinars, we will have Dr. Sar talk a little bit about the work he's doing. We're very fortunate, very grateful that we're able to also partner with him and ParksRx America on developing some programs here in DC. We'll be creating some campaigns, some materials for Latino and diverse audiences. So stay tuned. We're gonna get a lot of great surprises in the near future. I think we are going to wrap it up. Thank you very much, Kathy. Thank you very much, Tamberly, Mark, Sonia, for making sure that this that everything works. And thank you, everybody who joined us. Thank you for taking this time. We're really excited. I think I can already call this a huge success. And this just encourages us to keep doing it more. We'll continue this effort. We'll try to bring these topics to diverse new audiences, and we'll try to at the same time create materials, create outreach campaigns to support it. So with no further ado, I want to, again, happy International Day of Forest. Tomorrow is International Water Day, also an important date. And if you want to receive more information, if you're not already in our list, please do send an email to Sonia and expect that we will be providing some input. And again, thank you, everybody. Thank you for all the speakers, and we'll talk very soon.
Felipe, may I also mention that it is likely that the next webinar in the series will be around similar work, around the Nature Explorer and medical community, and also Nature RX in conjunction with Dr. Dan Porter, who is with the Lone Star Family Medical Center, and John Warner with the Texas A&M Forest Service, and also Corey Powell, who is with USDA, their faith-based community partnerships. So we are hopeful that you all will be able to join us in the next part of this wonderful series. Thank you so much, Felipe. Thank you, Corazon Latino, and everyone who's been able to join us today. Thank you, Dr. Wolf.
Muchas gracias a todos.
Thank you for participating.